For everything in the world except God. I think we ought to give the Lord a hand every now and then. Glad you're here this morning. If you are a guest at Twickenham, we are really honored to have you. Thanks for coming out to be with us today. And there's a card in the back of the seat in front of you. If you're a guest, please give us some information. We'd like to send you some information about our church. If you're looking for a church home, we're always looking for new family members. Just really glad you're here today. We're already standing. Let's just give somebody close by a hug and a handshake and let them know how glad you are that they are here. Hey, you were picking your nose here. How are you? How are you?
You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
For the grace of God has appeared that offers salvation to all people.
It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age.
While we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ,
who gave himself for us to redeem us from all wickedness and to purify for himself a people that are his very own, eager to do what is good.
Over all the earth you reign on high, every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, Lord, my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign.
March 5th, that's two Sundays from today, we will take our annual Hacienda of Hope Ecuador contribution, something that we do once a year, every year for the last many years. And so I want to make sure that as we ramp up to that, of course, we've had some special announcements last week. There'll be a special presentation next Sunday, but a really, really special treat today. This is so cool. One of the kids who grew up at the Hacienda, has been there for the last 12 years, graduated school down there and got accepted to Abilene Christian University. And so he has been at Abilene this year, and we got a chance to bring him back to this home, if you will, to be with us today. So Glenn Laird is here with John Seviano. You guys come up here, and they're going to share a couple things with us, and I know that you're going to love this. That's not...
Well, I got to tell you something. This is really cool. I can remember watching this kid grow up. In fact, my memories of John, we got those pictures. We got a few pictures up here of, that's John, it's not the girl for it. That's Andres and John and Sierra, but anyway, from a trip we made back when, how old were you in that picture, do you know?
Maybe seven. Or eight.
Just a little big guy. Wasn't he cute? He was, wasn't he? He's still our kind of, anyway. We won't go there, but anyway. So you came to the Hacienda when you were how old?
Maybe like around 7 or 8 years old.
7 years old. Okay, and what do you remember about that transition coming into the Hacienda?
Well, like my first memory I have was like when I got to like, me and my brothers and my cousins, we didn't know where we were going. So I remember we stayed like the night in this place, and I could see the road and all the buses and like cars like passed through the road. And it was like, that was something really different for me, because like back from where I was from, like there was barely like buses and cars, so there was like something different for me.
Yeah, you grew up in the jungle pretty much, didn't you?
Mm-hmm.
And so you were kind of coming into the big city when you came to Tabacundo. Yes. And then the kind of up the hill. When did it first, now one of the things that we're celebrating as we go through this period of kind of leading up to our contribution are transitions, because we've kind of gotten to the point where a young man like this who comes to the Hacienda of Hope at the age of 7 is now ready to go into life and really kind of a measure of what we're doing is in how this transition takes place, right? And so while it's never been our goal to see kids from the Hacienda come to the United States and go to school, and we want you to have an impact in Ecuador, right?
Yeah.
But at the same time, this opportunity came available. So how did this happen that you're going to Abilene?
So like, it was like 2 years before like I graduated from high school. I always wanted to come here, like, you know, you know the people that support, like the Hacienda and everything. And like, I also wanted to come and study here. That was something I was always wanted. So like, last summer, like there was an intern that went to the Hacienda and she stayed there like for 3 months. So during that time, I spent like 2 weeks in John and Justin's house. So I got to meet her and we were talking and she knew that I was about to graduate and she was like, she asked me like, what was my plan for after I graduated? So I was like, well, I was dreaming about like coming here in the States and study. So she was like, and like she talked, and like she told me about like that she was studying at ICU and everything. So, and like after she was like, so I told her about like what I wanted to do. So she was like, we can apply for colleges like in the States. So she helped me to apply to like Lipscomb and ACU, and like suddenly ACU accepted me. So I was like, it was like a dream come true for me.
So this is a big change in culture for you, right? Coming mm-hmm. to the United States, and you're on your own for the most part.
Yeah.
There's one, you think there's maybe one, maybe two other students from Ecuador who are at Abilene, mm-hmm. but it's pretty much you. Tell me how this has impacted your faith walk. A lot of us, when we go to college, we're on our own for the first mm-hmm. time. It changes, and so just how has that developed your faith in God?
Well, like now that I'm in ECU, it's just like at the beginning when I was in the Hacienda, like I was like kind of obligated to go to like church and service and everything. But now that I'm by my own, it's just like I don't have those people that watch me grow, like, and like, you know, like it made me like and remind me that there's a God, and like when I'm having trouble with my faith, there's not that people beside me that can tell me like, you know, there's a God and He loves you. So now like even though ECU is like a Christian school and it has like a Christian environment, it's not the same as having those people around. So in certain way, like going to church, that has like help me with my relationship with God. So now it's like I'm the one who is responsible for my faith. So that's.
Well, I tell you, I remember the first time that I went to Ecuador, 17 years ago. And I remember going into a church service and the whole thing was in Spanish. There was no translator. I know no Spanish, you know, none. Okay, and so I'm in this service and everything going on around me is in Spanish. And I remember the impressions that I had that day, because it still was this very worshipful mm-hmm. impression. I began to understand a little bit about how big God is, because in my own little mind, mm-hmm. I had kind of compartmentalized Him to be an English-speaking God. About, you know, ever since King James Version, right? God has always spoken English. But, you know, here He is, and we're in this environment where it's all in Spanish. And I remember especially when we came to this moment of the Lord's Supper, just having a unique appreciation for just how big our God is and just how big this community of believers is. You know, in English, we call this communion, what we're about to go into this morning. And it has that same root as the word community. And I think that's because it was intended to be partaken of in community. And John, what excites me today is that I get to share it with you. I get to share it with you here. And we get to share it with this body and believers. And in our hearts and our spirits, we share it with our family, your family, in Ecuador. And so all of us brought together because of a sacrifice, because of a broken body, because of shed blood. And especially in this age when our country seems so divided. Isn't it nice? Isn't it wonderful to have something that unifies us all as one? We're one. And so I'm going to ask my brother John to lead a prayer for us as we prepare to partake the Lord's Supper this morning, the bread.
Okay. Let's pray. Dear Father, thank you for this moment we have to worship your name. Thank you for all the blessings you have given us through all the week. Thank you for the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, the sacrifice in the cross that gave us a new life. Thank you for these wonderful people that help, that does this work in Ecuador. I ask you to bless the bread that represents the body of your Son crucified in the cross. I ask you that you keep blessing us through the rest of the week. It's in this name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
More like you, Jesus, more like you, fill my heart with your desire to make me more like you, Jesus, more like you, Jesus, more like you. Touch my lips with holy fire and make me more like you. Lord, you are my mercy. Lord, fill my heart with your desire.
Father in heaven, we're so grateful that you sometimes open our eyes to just how big you are and how big our family is. And so grateful, Father, for John and for the young man that he has become. And I just pray that you will continue to bless his life. I pray, Father, though, more than anything at this time, that you bring our peoples together. You bring your church together. You bring your church together from all over this globe. There's never been a time, Father, when we need the unity that comes from knowing Christ more than we do now. And Father, I just pray that you will touch our lives, help us to live lives that reflect what Jesus said and what Jesus did. And Father, give us the confidence to approach you knowing that the sins that have separated us from you have been washed away by the blood of Jesus. It's that blood, Father, that we remember at this time, and we celebrate our relationship with you because of Jesus' sacrifice. In his name we pray.
Who has the power to raise the dead? Who can save us from our sin? He is our hope, our righteousness. Jesus, only Jesus. Who can make the blind to see? Who holds the that set us free? He paid it all to bring us peace. Jesus, only Jesus. Holy King, Almighty Lord, saints and angels all adore. I joy with them. Jesus, only Jesus.
Let's stand.
Who can command the highest praise? Who has the name above all names? You stand alone, I stand amazed. Jesus, only Jesus. Holy angels all
seated.
John, thanks for being here today. A lot of us in this room have loved you without even knowing you, and they've loved all the kids down at the Hacienda and from a distance. So we're really honored that you're here today. If you don't know about it, the Hacienda, it's called Hacienda of Hope. It's in Ecuador, and it's a home for children who need one. And in addition to providing them a place to live, food, shelter, and clothing, and love, there's a school there as well, and they're provided an education. And it is our mission work. We don't have any other foreign mission efforts other than the Hacienda. So we're really grateful to have John here today and to be a part of that. And then in a couple of weeks, as Lincoln mentioned, we'll be taking up a special collection for them. And we're looking to raise a lot of money. I think our goal is around 240, 249, 260, 246. $246,000. So we want you to be in prayer about that, and we really want you to give to it. It's a really important work for us. So we're going to be in a lot of different passages this morning. If you want to land on one, you can go to the book of 1 Peter chapter 1. I'm sorry, 2 Peter chapter 1. That'll be one of the ones we get to that we'll take a look at this morning. We're in between series this morning. We'll start a new series in a couple of weeks called High Definition Faith, or Faith HD. And that'll be sort of a series that we come back to from time to time. And in this first installment of High Definition Faith, we're going to talk about who God is. That's a great series for folks that maybe struggle with some doubt about who God is. They're not really sure He exists. They're not really sure what He's like if He exists. So it'd be a good thing for you to bring some friends to. Some neighbors or some co-workers that maybe struggle with some of that. But we'll be really trying to achieve a higher definition of our faith, to really understand what we believe in this first installment about who and what God is. So that's what we'll be doing in a couple of weeks. In Bristol, England, there is a zoo. And, of course, there's a parking lot where people park their cars and buses to go to the zoo. And for years, there was an attendant that was almost as much of an attraction as the things in the zoo, not because he was odd or anything like that, but just because he was such a pleasant human being. I mean, he was just a super nice guy and knew as much about the zoo as a lot of the people who worked inside the walls. He just made that whole awful experience of finding a parking place kind of pleasant. Everybody looked forward to meeting the parking lot attendant at the Bristol Zoo. And then one day he just wasn't there. He just wasn't there. And nobody knew where he'd gone. And so a couple of days passed and nobody showed up to take his place. They figured maybe he was sick. So the zoo called the Bristol City Council and said, hey, you guys need to send another parking lot attendant out. We don't know what happened to the parking lot attendant, but we got to have somebody out here to collect the money and help. And the city council said, oh, he doesn't work for us. We thought he worked for you. And the zoo said, no, we thought he worked for you. And it turns out this very pleasant zookeeper had been working for him, a parking lot attendant had been working for himself for 25 years, for a quarter of a century. And they started calculating how much the parking had cost, and they figured he had made over $10 million working, just stealing money from people at a parking lot. I'm not saying you should do this, okay? It's an idea. It's a sinful idea. Don't do that. So, and then there's this guy in North Carolina who bought a bunch of very expensive cigars, just a bunch of them, and then he had them insured against fire. He got an insurance company to insure these cigars against fire. And then he smoked them all. And then he filed a claim. And the insurance company said, we're not going to pay that claim. And he said, well, they were destroyed by fire. And they said, well, we're not going to do that. And so he took them to court. And the judge, this is what the judge said. The judge said, look, you didn't say what kind of fire. So you got to pay the guy. So the insurance company cut him a check. They didn't appeal it. They cut him a check for, this is in North Carolina now, they cut him a check for $15,000 to cover the cigars. As soon as he cashed it, they arrested him on charges of arson. And he went to jail, one count for every cigar. That's a lot of cigars, a lot of jail time. So do you believe those two stories? I hope not, because they're not true. Those are urban legends, like the one from October of last year that claimed a homeless man discovered under a bridge in San Francisco was Elvis Presley. DNA test confirmed it, and the FBI admitted that he'd been in the witness program since 1977, August of 1977, in fact, because that's when he died. I remember it. I was painting a room on Prince Avenue in Athens, Georgia. You remember stuff like that. The color was taupe. It was an interior latex. I know. And I was listening to the radio, and I know where I was and what I felt when Elvis died. It was tragic. But they didn't find him in San Francisco. He's at Graceland. He's in a tomb there. There are lots of false stories on the internet. More false stories, I think, than true ones. Lemmings do not periodically jump off cliffs. Elephants are not afraid of mice. Frogs will not remain in a pot of water that is slowly brought to a boil until they are cooked to death. My brother and I discovered that when we were 12 and 9. Chihuahuas are not really genetically engineered to look like dogs. And you cannot buy a penguin online at penguinwarehouse.com. You can, however, go to Snopes.com or truthorfiction.com and check out the stories that you incessantly email to each other. Since we are so gullible when it comes to irreligious urban legends, it should not surprise us that we sometimes take the bait on spiritual urban legends as well. So I want to give you four of them, four false assumptions, four legends about spiritual growth that I think a lot of us buy into. Here's the first one. This is the legend. Spiritual growth is automatic once I become a Christian. Spiritual growth is, once I become a Christian, I'm just automatically going to grow. That's not true. It's not automatic. It has to be intentional. In Matthew 28, Jesus told his apostles, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. Disciples have to be made and taught. That is not an automatic process. Acts chapter 2, the very first Christians devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. Even Jesus had to learn. Luke 2:52 says that he grew in wisdom. Hebrews says that he had to learn obedience. The truth is, churches, and maybe even this church, churches are full of people who have been Christians for decades but haven't grown an inch. Now, part of the fault lies with the institution. Sometimes church leaders think that once we get somebody into the baptistry, our work is done. We get them convicted, convinced, and rinsed, and we're done. Praise God. Who's next? Baptism's only the beginning, though. There is a Bible full of teaching that needs to take place. There are gifts that need to be discovered. There are disciplines that need to be developed. So the institution's got a responsibility, but you and I do here as well. I love what John talked about earlier when he was saying that when he was at the Hacienda, that that community was sort of what kept him going to church and praying and doing all of the things required for spiritual growth. But now he's at college. He's away from all of that, and he has to take more responsibility for it. You and I have to take responsibility for our growth as well. One of the things that we need to learn and be reminded of regularly is that we are the institution. We are the church. Spiritual growth is not the responsibility of some other person, some anonymous they need to come up with programs to help me grow. It's your responsibility and it's mine. I like the way Paul put it in Philippians 2. Continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. That sounds to me like Paul is telling us that growth is an intentional process that requires my personal commitment and constant attention. Spiritual growth is not automatic. If you are not intentionally pursuing a deeper walk with God, a deeper relationship with God, more knowledge about who He is and what He expects of you, then you are simply not going to grow. It's not automatic. Urban legend number two about spiritual growth: it's mystical, and maturity is only for a special select few. It's false. It's not, spiritual growth is not esoteric, it's practical. I kind of know where this one may have come from. During the first century and even earlier, there was a group of people who began to assert that they had a kind of special knowledge that they had received from God. They had special insights. They knew some secrets that nobody else knew, that some things had been revealed to them that were not revealed to everybody else. In fact, could not be revealed to everybody else. And there was a name for this group. They were called the Gnostics, G-N-O-S-T-I-C, the Gnostics. The word Gnostic, it comes from the Greek word for knowledge. So these folks believe they possess this special secret knowledge that regular folks could not get. They were wrong. I want you to listen to what Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. This is really powerful stuff here. He writes, His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these, He has given us very great and precious promises so that through them, you may participate in the divine nature. You may participate. You may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, to brotherly kindness love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, notice the idea of growth there, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's not mystical. Spiritual growth is not mystical. It's practical. It's not monkish. It's pedestrian. It's not mysterious. It's plain as dirt. It gets down into the grit and grime of life. It's about how you live with your spouse or your children or your parents in your house on a Tuesday night. It's how you treat the server at your favorite restaurant at lunch on Wednesday. It's how you leave that clerk at the convenience store or the cashier at the grocery store feeling when you walk out of those establishments. It's how you treat your coworkers. It gets down into life. It has something to say about how you handle your anger or your anxiety, your frustrations or your fears. Spiritual growth doesn't wear a toga. It wears blue jeans. It's not for some spiritual elite. It's for regular people like you, like me. Urban legend number three: spiritual maturity can occur instantly if I can just find the magic key. No, it's not that nimble. Spiritual growth is plodding. This is a fun exercise sometime. Go to Amazon and just start perusing the titles of Christian books. The 7 Spiritual Habits That Will Change Your Life Forever. 7 Keys to Intimacy with Jesus. Four absurd decisions God wants you to make today. Five keys to effective spiritual growth. There are thousands of book titles built on that same formula. Here's the formula: random number plus breathless adjective plus the word keys, habit, or decision equals spiritual growth. I'm going to write a book. I'm going to write five books with all that formula, and I'm going to make millions, and then you won't have to pay me a dime. You have to pay some other preacher, but you won't have to pay me. The truth is, we're all, you know, we're guilty of that here in the Church of Christ. We're guilty of turning a lifelong process into a two-minute drill. How many of you have ever heard the five-finger gospel? Hear, believe, repent, confess, and be baptized. Heaven. Like that. Worship. Sounds like it'd be really complicated, right? No. Sing, pray, preach, Lord's Supper, give. Five. Biblical interpretation. This is a very ancient document. I mean, this thing spans, wow, thousands of years, 40 different writers, three different languages. You would think it would be hard to interpret. Not at all. It's easy. Command, example, necessary inference. Christianity, it's easy. Just add water. Look, the Bible does not know anything about instant sanctification. Paul told Timothy to preach the word with patience. Peter called his readers to perseverance. He reassured them, don't worry, God is patient. You don't need patience and perseverance if spiritual growth comes in a can. The problem with get-good-quick schemes is that they never deliver what they promise. Christians who buy into that kind of thinking are like athletes who take steroids. They want to get muscle without making the sacrifice. And just like steroids, it comes with some nasty side effects, because when trouble comes, when hardships hit, when Satan attacks, Christians who took a shortcut to spiritual growth are going to fall. Now, the good news is I can tell you exactly how long it's going to take you to reach the goal of spiritual maturity. It's going to take you the rest of your life, which is what we talked about last week. The journey is long. It lasts a lifetime. Okay, one last myth. Spiritual growth is what we've talked about so far. This is the last one. Spiritual growth is a personal, private matter. It's none of your business if I grow. It's none of my business if you grow. It's just personal and private. That's fiction for two reasons. First, if you grow in your faith, it is going to have an impact on people around you, a positive one. If you don't grow in your faith, it is going to have an impact on people around you, a negative one. Your growth is very much a concern of mine, and my growth is very much a concern of yours. This myth really reflects kind of a cultural thing right now. This whole, I get control of my own body and I get to do what I want to do with me, and you can't tell me what to do and you can't force your opinions on me, and what I do is my business and none of yours. It assumes that we're sort of isolated from one another and don't have any impact on each other, which is crazy. We do. The second reason this idea that spiritual growth is personal and it's all about me and doesn't have anything to do with you is that nobody grows alone. Nobody grows alone. That's not to say that you and I don't have responsibility, don't have to take personal responsibility for our growth. We do. What I mean is that we're not going to be able to do it by ourselves. The Bible doesn't know anything about the brave loner who's taking on the world single-handedly. It does talk about a team effort. Here's a very famous passage, Hebrews chapter 10. Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another. Look at all those inclusive words there. Let us, we, one another, let us, together, let us, one another, over and over again. He just sort of piles those things on. You cannot grow by yourself. You need the support, the encouragement, and the accountability of a group. I have been more faithful, now it doesn't look like it yet, okay, but I have been more faithful consistent in going to the gym in the last 3 months than at any time in my life, because I've got somebody holding me accountable. I got a guy that calls me a couple of times a week and says, when are you going to the gym this week? And he meets me there, and he embarrasses me, and he shames me, and he encourages me. He encourages me. You know what experts say about fitness? They say that 20% of success in fitness comes from having a good plan. 20% comes from having a good plan. 80% of success in getting fit comes from support and accountability, which is absolutely biblical. Acts chapter 2, they devoted themselves. It was a group effort. Attention to the apostles' teaching, the fellowship, the Lord's Supper, the prayer. It was a group effort. In Romans 3, Paul said that each member belongs to all. I'm sorry, Romans 12, Paul says that each member belongs to all the others. In Galatians 6, he said, y'all need to carry each other's burdens. This past week, I talked to one of our relatively newer members about some struggles they were having. And one of the things that has helped him, he said, was spending time with brothers who encourage him and sometimes challenge him. He's growing because he isn't trying to do it by himself. We're trying to facilitate this a little bit here at Twickenham right now, this concept of growing together. We're working on that in several ways. Recently, we repurposed this room right over here. We put in these chairs and this coffee bar, not because we want to be comfortable, but because we want to create a space, an environment where people will sit down and talk to each other, where you and I can sit out there and talk to each other. I would love to come through there every Sunday morning and just see folks sitting out there talking, not during the sermon, right, but sitting out there talking to one another, leaning in toward each other, sharing what's going on with your life. That's why that's there. We've redesigned our adult Sunday school program. They're called journey groups now. We are on this journey together. And we are asking you to make a commitment to one of those groups to say, I'm going to be here on Sunday mornings at 9 o'clock with that group of people, and we are going to walk the journey together. You cannot do this by yourself. Thinking that you can do it by yourself is a myth. It's an urban legend, and you will fail. If you try to do it by yourself, you will fail. I know you will fail, because I tried, and it doesn't go well. It doesn't go well. Now, if any of this offends you, I've got good news. There's a company in Japan that has developed a robot preacher. Masai Origami is the director, promotions director for Robaki Industries. He says the robots look just like people and can be programmed to speak up to 1,000 phrases and come fully loaded with 15 of the most popular Bible translations. The current price is $15,000 for the base model, but for $25,000, you can get a fully loaded model which can produce realistic-looking tears and a trembling lower lip. Do you believe that? No. That's about as likely as getting to heaven and telling Jesus, I did it all by myself. You can go anywhere else in eternity all by yourself. Heaven is a mass transit trip. Spiritual growth is intentional. It is practical. It is popular. And by that I mean it's for everybody, not just a select few. And it is relational. There's only one thing in the world that sounds too good to be true, but still is true. Jesus knows you, and Jesus knows me through and through, and he loves us anyway. Salvation is a free gift. Heaven is real. And even people like you and me can go there because of Jesus. That's not a myth. That's truth. Hey, we're going to stand and sing again and be done. And listen, you go out and have a great week this week. Take the truth with you and tell it every chance you get. Let's stand.
Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Lord, reign in me, reign in your power over all my dreams. In my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Hey, don't forget all the stuff that's in your bulletin this morning about children's ministry, about youth ministry, about 39ers ministry, and wedding showers, and all kinds of great stuff that's going on. Also, this one note, we will begin rehearsing an Easter chorus this coming Wednesday night. Rehearsals will be on Wednesdays in the last classroom on the right. So if you're interested in singing at Easter, please come and join us at the regular hour, 6:30. Thanks for being here, and we'll close in prayer.
Would you please bow with me? Father God, what an awesome day of worship to come before you. We've learned more of your word, and we've been able to sing songs of praise to you. We stand in awe of your greatness. We know that you are our Redeemer and the living God. We ask you to reign in us. Thank you for bringing John from Ecuador to inspire us to be made more and more and more like you. As we wrap up, Father, what we call formal or corporate worship, please help us to keep in mind that we walk out these doors and we walk right into the mission field. Help us to focus on humbly serving others as you continue to transform us moment by moment into your image. Teach us to obey your word, to intentionally study your word as Jody has encouraged us this morning, to continually work out our salvation with fear and trembling. And Father, help us to remember that you and you alone are enough. In Jesus' name we humbly pray. Amen.